Hello everyone. Today in this module, we are going to talk about vernalization. Different plants have different cycles of vegetative growth, flowering and fruiting. Some biennials produce vegetative structures in one season and induce flowering only after they are exposed to prolonged winter or cold conditions. Such cold requiring plants also need an appropriate photoperiod for flowering. Therefore, such biennial plants can be made to flower in the same season by subjecting them to cold treatment. The process of acquiring the ability or capacity to accelerate the process of flowering in response to cold treatment is referred to as vernalization. So, let's study more about vernalization and its significance to plants. The learning objectives of this module are introduction to vernalization, discovery of vernalization, what stage of plant responds to vernalization, temperature effect, effect of water and oxygen, vernalin, devernalization, gibberellin as substitute for vernalization, regulation of gene expression by vernalization, and vernalization promotes flowering by causing an epigenetic shut off of FLC. So, we will be studying these things. The winter rye called Sikale cereal or Petkus rye is a biennial plant which requires cold treatment for successful cultivation as one season crop. The grains of these plants are known for their hardiness and quality for the purpose of milling and baking. In fact, farmers used to cultivate this variety by subjecting the water imbibed grains to cold treatment, then growing them in the spring and harvesting them in summer. Clipper reported this phenomenon and extensive research work was done in this field. Among many plants, Petkus rye was the first to be used for experimentation. The other examples are Hyoscyamus niger, Triticum estivum, Lunaria biensis, Arabidopsis thaliana, Lolium perennial, Beta vulgaris, Brassica oleracea and others. J. Gus Stef Grasner in 1928 was a German plant physiologist. He worked on rye, that is Sikale cereal, and found that flowering and fruiting depended on a cold temperature exposure of plants during early stages of growth. Grasner planted winter rye in spring. The seeds germinated and produced vegetative plants, but they did not flower until late in the growing season. The winter variety required low temperature to induce flowering. Grasner found that winter Petkin rye could be given low temperature requirement artificially. He placed imbibed seeds in chilling temperatures between 2 to 5 degrees centigrade for 5 to 6 weeks. He planted the chilled seeds in the spring. They grew and flowered like spring. Thus, he discovered the phenomenon of vernalization. Let's see that at which stage do the plants respond to vernalization. Vernalization through cold temperature is effective at the seed or seedling stage. In some cereals, even embryos can be successfully vernalized. However, in many cold requiring species, vernalization is not effective until the plant possesses at least few leaves. The requirement of new leaves for effective vernalization is called ripeness to flowering. This suggests that leaves are perceptive to cold treatment, as we can see in the slide. The stages of plant growth that show sensitivity to cold treatment. Similarly, when embryos of Petkus rye are separated from the endosperm and the isolated embryos are subjected to cold treatment, they do not get vernalized. However, if isolated embryos are placed in sucrose solution or along with endospermous tissue, when subjected to cold treatment, vernalization is very effective. Probably, the role of carbohydrates in vernalization is to supply energy to the meristematic tissue in the shoot apex of embryo, which gives rise to organ formation in response to cold temperature. The effect of temperature. For induction of flowering, a cold treatment of 3 degrees centigrade to 17 degrees centigrade for short duration is required by some plants at the seedling stage. The requirement of cold treatment in bringing about vernalization is determined as a reduction in the number of days between germination and flowering stage. After this brief exposure to cold, the plants need to be grown at optimum temperature that enable metabolic processes to be carried out to achieve vegetative growth and development. The effect of water and oxygen. By just treating the seedlings with cold temperature, the seedlings do not vernalize. Along with the cold temperature, plants also require water and oxygen for effective vernalization. The seeds or embryos should possess at least 40% to 50% water in their cells, without which cold treatment has no effect. Similarly, oxygen is very essential since it is required for biological oxidation taking place during respiration. It is difficult to explain how cells use carbohydrates and oxygen for respiration at low temperatures during vernalization. Let's talk about vernalin. Various experiments in the past have revealed that during cold treatment, the meristematic cells found either in stem apex or leaves are stimulated to produce some substance. The presence of such substance has been demonstrated by drafting a vernalized plant to another non-vernalized plant at normal temperatures. If the cut shoot tip of a vernalized plant is grafted on the decapitated stem of a non-vernalized plant, flowering is induced in the latter. This indicates that some substance that is called vernalin is synthesized in vernalized plants and transported to the non-vernalized plant to induce flowering. Attempts to isolate and identify vernalin have been failed. Briefing about the devernalization. If vernalized seedlings or seeds are grown at higher temperature, like 35 to 40 degrees centigrade, the plants fail to flower. Such a nullifying effect of higher temperatures is called devernalization. Nevertheless, if the vernalized plants are maintained at sufficiently low temperatures for a longer period of time, which has to be determined for every species, devernalization does not occur. This may be because vernalin formed during cold temperature exposure may already have committed the plants to flowering. However, devernalized plants can be revernalized by subjecting the same seedling for another period of cold treatment by repetition of vernalization and devernalization cycles. The effect of high temperature eruption during low temperature treatment on inflorescence formation in turnip plants were investigated. Plants were exposed to 9 degrees centigrade with interruptions of 17 degree, 24 degree or 30 degree centigrade for 4, 6 and 8 hours per day. After the treatment, flower formation indexes were calculated. Based on these data, the total hours of vernalization and hours of vernalization or devernalization per day were estimated. Flower formation indexes lower in the group of plants exposed to high temperature interruption than in the group of plants exposed to continuous low temperature. Moreover, the higher the interrupted temperature became, the longer its duration per day, the lower the flower formation index became. Gibberellins as substitute for vernalization. If plants are treated with the gibberellins, they produce flowers without subjecting the plant to cold and photoperiodic treatments. For example, henbane is a rosette leaved long day plant which requires cold treatment for flowering. If non-vernalized, henbane plants are sprayed with GA, the plants produce flowers, indicating that gibberellin application may substitute vernalization treatment and bring about an induction of flowering. Regulation of gene expression by vernalization. Several signaling pathways have been identified in Arabidopsis thaliana that bring about the induction of flowering. These include the photoperiodic pathway, the autonomous pathway, the GA induced pathway and the vernalization pathway, all of which play a role in regulating the spatial and temporal induction of flowering. In the slide, we can see the pathways controlling flowering time in Arabidopsis. The genes that play a role in signaling for flowering in response to cold treatment or vernalization treatment include vernalization in sensitive 3, that is wind 3, vernalization 1, VRN 1, and vernalization 2, that is VRN 2. Another gene, VER203, was shown to be activated under cold temperature exposure as well as by GA application. Proteins coded for by the vernalization pathway genes are known to downregulate the expression of floral expression, that is the flowering locus C, FLC, thus upregulating the expression of genes that play a role in floral induction pathway integrins like suppressor of overexpression of constants 1, SOC1, flowering locus T, FT, and leafy, that is LFY. The flowering investigators in turn activate floral meristematic identity, that is FMI gene, epitala 1, epitala 2, fruitful, that is FUL, and cauliflower, that is CAL, which convert the vegetative meristem to a floral meristem. The perception of cold stimulus is thought to take place in leaves, which leads to the activation of a mobile signal flowering locus T, that is FT, that moves to the shoot apex through the phloem and brings about the activation of floral integer gene. FT therefore is thought to qualify as vernalin, reported in early grafting experiments, since it moves from induced leaves to the meristems to produce flowering. Photoperiodic induction of flowering was also shown to involve a mobile signal called florigen or vernalin, which has been identified as the FT protein. Vernalization promotes flowering by causing an epigenetic shutoff of FLC. Vernalization occurs at the seedling stage while flowering occurs later in the life cycle of plants. The meristem thus has to remember the cold stimulus over several cycles of cell division, suggestive of an epigenetic response. It was hypothesized that DNA methylation is the epigenetic mark that enables the cell to recall previous cold conditions. The epigenetic basis of vernalization was shown by Jendal et al. The protein VRN2 was shown to bind at the FLC locus and change its structure by recruiting a chromatin remodeling complex. This epigenetic mark possibly enables the plant to remember periods of cold temperature till several weeks later. The shutoff of the FLC locus by VRN2 is thought to bring about floral induction. In the figure, we can see the action of VRN2 in bringing about chromatin remodeling at the FLC locus. To summarize this module, cold temperature exposure at the seedling stage is required to induce flowering in some plants. This phenomenon was first observed in experiments carried out with Pitcus rice plants by Gassner. Leaves are thought to perceive the cold temperature signal, and for effective vernalization, carbohydrate metabolism is essential. The vernalization signal has been shown to pass through graft junctions and has been called as vernalin. GA can substitute vernalization as a flowering inducer. Vernalization leads to activation of several genes whose product play an important role in inhibiting the activity of floral repressor, flowering locus C, that is FLC, and the subsequent activation of the floral integrators like SOC1, FT, and API, which in turn activate the floral meristem identity genes, leading to induction of flowering. Perception of cold signal probably leads to synthesis of FT, which moves from leaves to the shoot apex to bring about the transition to flowering. FT has been identified as the mobile signal florigen that transmits the photoperiod signal from leaves to shoot apex. The vernalization induced protein, that is VRN2, has been shown to alter the structure of FLC locus at the seedling stage by recruiting chromatin remodeling complexes, which serves as an epigenetic mark in suppressor of the FLC expression at the later stage. Thank you.